What's going on? What is cracking? Is it cracking? Is it lacking? Is it clacking? What's going on? It's your boy, Fat Samurai Guy, and Lady Fabblood.
I don't think you were sure about any of what you just said.
It's fun. I'm off the cuff, man. Okay. You don't know what's going to come out. What is going on, Movie Dojo Army and everybody watching right now? What is going on? Another odd time of the day. We're doing a little live stream discussion. We're going to talk about Squid Game a little bit and go into spoilers. And Venom 2, Electric Boogaloo, Let There Be Carnage with spoiler talk as well. We tried to do it in the car when we reviewed Venom, but we kind of ran out of time and we couldn't do it. So we're like, we'll do a little bit of a live stream here and hang out with all you badasses and talk movies and TV shows. Who's here in the house? Who do we have today? Omniblast! What is going on? That's right. What is cracking? I hope you're doing well, Omniblast. We got King Venom Zilla in the house. How you doing, my friend? We got AJ Mason. Oh, yeah. We got Kevin Lambert. Kaiju goodness. Oh, shit. Look who's here. Look who's here. It's your boy Tino. What's going on, my friend? How you doing? All right. And Eric, what's going on? All right. We got enough badasses hanging out with us today on a very odd time of the day, but it's fun. It's like, you know, fuck it. Any way to sneak her in. You got to do it around these times. What's up, Brad? What's going on? What's cracking? Shogun, what's cracking? How you doing? All right, let's
go. Hush up, Brad. Enough for you, dude.
Oh, man. All right, so let's go ahead and get into Squid Game.
First of all, we had a very interesting weekend. I had a very rare three-day weekend.
Uh-huh.
We decided to go out to the Chino Plains of Fame to check out the B-17 Sentimental Journey. They were doing tours. You could go in and actually get inside the B-17. So Thursday, fun. Friday, we went and saw one of the dumbest movies ever made, a la Venom 2. And we were hearing all about this Korean sensation that is sweeping Netflix called Squid Game.
Yeah.
I didn't see anything about it. He was just like, hey, we got to check this out. Everyone's talking about it. So after we came home from Venom, we pretty much dove right into Squid Game and binged that from Friday all the way into Saturday, killed that Saturday. And then we watched the Stepfather film.
Right, which we'll not talk about today.
So,
we may talk about it tomorrow.
Saw a couple of cheesy B movies also, aside from that. So we had a really full, robust weekend. Very interesting weekend. So we decided, let's take today. I got a little bit of time before I gotta dive into my 6-day week.
Woo-hoo. 6-day work week. Yeah, she's busy, man.
And Squid Game. I cannot tell you how irritated I am that I have to keep resorting to South Korean media, both television and films, for my entertainment because Hollywood repeatedly is letting me down. Why?
Well, foreign countries take more risks with things. You know what I mean? Sometimes we get some good shit over here, but it seems to be rare. But then again, not everything from Korea is great now. Don't forget about Peninsula.
It's true.
Don't forget about Peninsula bullshit.
It's true.
But my when we got done watching Squid Game, it was, well, I think I turned to you and I said, man, it's really nice to watch a show and just like, yay, it wasn't a waste of fucking time. Like, we weren't like horribly disappointed, because sometimes things get overhyped, right? And that was one of the reasons why we wanted to hurry up and binge it during the weekend, because we knew there were going to be tons of spoilers, and, you know, we didn't want any things to be spoiled, so.
Mm-hmm. Which we're going to do the shit out of today, so I'm sorry. If you haven't watched it, you might want to.
It's in the title, it's in the description, and it's right here, right there, so.
And
spoiler alert, spoiler warning.
It took 9 episodes to give me a satisfying experience that I do not get in 7 years of a fucking TV series, of any given TV series. Because something that we excel at here in the States is we just overstay our welcome and we drag shit out. And we just, we have to keep things going because, oh, we got to make that money.
Yeah.
We have to sacrifice the story.
Right.
For the sake of, oh, money, 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 money. It's like, no, you should have ended this 5 years ago, you know, or several seasons ago. And, you know, that's unfortunately. And, yeah, you know, this could very well go into a season two.
Right, which we'll talk about.
But at the same time, I still got a satisfying experience the first time around.
Right, right, right. But, yeah, let's go ahead and talk a little bit about Squid Games. That's right. Plot synopsis. Hundreds of cash-strapped players accept a strange invitation to compete in children's games. Inside, a tempting prize awaits with deadly high stakes, a survival game that has a whopping $45.6 billion won prize at stake, or their very own PS5. another reason why I want, what kind of motivated me to watch this was our boys was in this.
Mm.
Byung-Hun Lee is a badass. A Bittersweet Life, The Good, The Bad, The Weird. I mean, this guy's phenomenal. I Saw the Devil. He is amazing. So we were like, anything this guy is in.
The Magnificent Seven.
If you want to include that.
That was a joke.
He was good at it. I mean, you know. If you want to include him in that. But, yeah, that was one of the reasons why we really wanted to watch it. So, let's see here. I'm just checking out some of the comments here. Nate Dogg says, Hollywood, especially for the past 10 years, have been playing it way too safe. Brolicon says, Hollywood is doing the subvert expectations way too much nowadays. That's kind of true, yeah. Let's see here. All right, so let's go ahead and talk a little bit about it here. So, we have the character of Homewrecker. All right, Homewrecker, basically, this guy, he lives with his mother. He steals from his mother to appease his gambling habits. He's a horrible father and husband. I mean, he does love his daughter. He loves his daughter, but, you know, obviously she, you know, him and his wife are not together anymore. She's with another brother. And, you know, he does care for his daughter, but he's just... Everything horrible in his life is this guy's fault. You don't really feel bad for this character until a little bit later, when you with really good writing and character development, you actually start to like the character later, especially when you get to the Squid Games. But take over whenever you want.
Well, okay. So first of all, Let me just kind of put this out there, because what's going to happen with this series, it's the same thing that happened with the film Parasite. People are going to come late to the game.
Yeah.
And they're going to watch this and they're going to go, oh, well, this is just Running Man meets Battle Royale. What's the big deal? Okay. There's a fair point. You've seen this plot in other shapes and forms before.
There's a lot of shows like this out there.
There's a lot of movies and media out there with this similar plot, with this similar structure, in that you've got a bunch of desperate people who are gathered up, who want money, and who are forced to do really terrible things. Mm-hmm. And at some point you figure out that a bunch of rich people are behind it. Surviving the Game.
I mean, there's a lot.
Yeah, there's other media.
Hard Target.
Right, right.
As the God's Will is similar.
There's
a lot.
There's other media out there that have done this.
Yeah.
But what this series specializes in is that you get a lot of complexities that you're not going to get in a lot of these other pieces of media, because you have 9 episodes. Ranging from 50 minutes to an hour. The shortest episode is episode, I think...
Was it 7?
I think it's episode 7 or 8.
Right.
Where it's only 30 minutes long. Just about 31 minutes long. And again, all the stories are utilized to complete perfection, in that they tell the story they need to tell. They get in, they get out. But none of them feel like they drag. None of them feel like they're fluff.
Right.
And each of the characters are given the development that they need.
Yeah.
And they're given the backstory that they need. Even the main character, You know, he's a loser. And yeah, he, as soon as he gets a little bit of cash in his hand, he's going to spend it. And he's, you know, he's going to be wasteful and he's going to do the wrong thing. And then you kind of find out that he's had this kind of traumatic past. He worked at this factory at one point, and the day his daughter was born, there was this terrible strike at his factory, and he watched a friend of his die. And, you know, there's this weird story behind, you know, his bullshit and all of his bad habits. And, you know, does it excuse what he does? No. But he grows a lot throughout the story. Mm-hmm. There's this golden boy of his particular province that he lives in, that he gets this backstory, and he is a terrible person, but you kind of understand what he's trying to do to survive. But my God, he is a terrible person. He's an absolutely atrocious person. But everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people do a lot of terrible things to survive.
Right.
And you kind of understand where they're coming from. And that's the thing that you're going to get in this story that you're not necessarily going to get in a lot of the other shorter versions of this story.
Right, right, right.
And some of the twists and turns, not necessarily all of them, I would say, pay off. There's this subplot where there's a cop that shows up and you find out that his brother played the game several years ago, and he's involved in the Squid Game. And he's actually kind of like a sub-commander of the whole thing. I'm not really sure why we had all of that, because it doesn't really resolve in any way, but it was a thing that happened.
Yeah.
It was kind of like a little extra layer.
You're talking about this character?
The cop? Yes.
Okay.
The cop.
Right.
And
his brother, the big reveal is front man.
The big reveal.
Who's kind of in charge of the games, who's not...
He's
not,
like the second in command of the game.
Right. It's played by our boy, Byung-Hun Lee here.
Right.
You find out it's revealed. Well, he discovers...
He discovers at one point, because he went missing, and he you know, finds out that, hey, my brother played this game several years ago, and he won.
And he won, yeah.
And, well, why did he come back, and why did he decide to be a ringleader for these games?
Yeah,
well,
you never
know. We don't find out.
We don't really know, yeah.
And... Yeah. The cop ends up getting shot.
Right.
Does he survive? Probably not. You know,
I'm gonna say before the success of this show. Hold on. Before the success of the show, this character is dead. Now that the show is successful, he's not dead. He just got shot in the shoulder.
Right.
Fell off the cliff. You know, they're probably going to do something like that. But we'll talk about that a little bit later. But
right. So the most interesting thing that I found was in the very first episode, you get a bunch of backstory, and so the main character comes across this card. He gets invited to the game. You get jumped into the first game, which is Red Light, Green Light.
Yeah.
And that's where the first shit goes down. And
oh my God.
The theme throughout the whole series is that every single horrible game where everybody's brutally mowed down, it's all based on children's games that they play in Korea.
Right.
And the red light, green light is, as it says, the big doll's head turns around, the eyes are motion sensors.
Yeah.
And as soon as the doll's head's turned around, you better freeze, and you're timed. You have X amount of minutes to get across the finish line. If that doll sees you move, you're going to get blown away. And nobody understands it at first. They think it's a joke.
Right.
And as soon as everybody starts to realize what's going on, now, first, there are 456 people in the game. And as soon as everybody starts to realize, oh, shit, people are dying, they panic, and so, like, a ton of people are just blown away in the the first couple of seconds of the game. And so, once the game starts to really get going, you're introduced more to kind of the core cast, as it were.
Right.
And by the end of the game, people start to realize, oh, shit, this is real.
Yeah.
And by the end of that first game, people are introduced to the rules. And one of the rules is that if the majority decides that they want to leave... Mm-hmm. You can go. You don't get anything, but you can go. And so there's this big debate, and people take a vote, and it's very, very close, but majority rules, everybody leaves.
And this one, I was tripping out. because this whole first game was like so violent and satisfying. You know, when Homewrecker wakes up, I'm just gonna call him Loser. When Loser wakes up, and there's like hundreds upon hundreds of people there, like just a huge amount of people there. I was like, "Ooh, big body count! Mm-hmm. Big body count's coming! All right, wee fun!" Right. And especially when this character showed up, I love this old man. At first,
right?
I love this old man. At first, I was like, "Dude, this guy's my favorite character because he's just having fun during the games." You know, at the time, mm-hmm. I loved the character at the time. Mm-hmm. People got destroyed, mowed down, and it was a very entertaining sequence. But that's what tripped me big time was the episode after that where they let people go.
Yeah.
If they wanted to go.
Everybody went home.
That was insane. I was like, how could you? But then when they, Loser goes and runs to the cops and tells them all this crazy, insane stuff that's like a fantasy world to the cops. They're like, are you on drugs? Like, Do you need help? and he describes right. what's happening. They're like, right. okay. So no one believes them. So of course they're going to let people go.
So, and of course not everybody wanted to leave because right. they wanted a shot at that money. Once everybody was panicking once everybody saw the bodies and all the blood and everything.
Yeah.
But once they saw, oh shit, there's a giant cash prize involved. And mm-hmm. they realized that one person's going to walk out of here with $46 billion or whatever it is.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, some people started to really fucking calm down.
Mm-hmm.
But majority ruled, and so they all got to leave. And so the next episode, Hell, is where you start to see the aftermath of what people are dealing with in their lives yeah. after the fact. And a lot of people start to realize, my life is still shit.
Yeah.
And it's inescapable. I'm still in debt. And I can't get out of it. Some people are, you find out that the golden boy of the village that they live in, that Loser and,
218.
Right.
Yeah.
Judas. He's up to his ass in debt. It's not just the Loser. He's up to his ass in debt. He's put up all this shit as collateral. He basically lost his mom's little restaurant. It's not a restaurant. It's like a stand. It's like a food stand.
Yeah.
His mom doesn't know. His mom is thinking that he's in America being successful and all this. But the cops are looking for him. The equivalent of the feds almost. He's in really bad shape, mm-hmm. But he's too much of a coward to say anything.
Yeah.
He's in a lot of financial trouble. And you see all these other sub characters and the aftermath of them. You see the young female, she's kind of like the
pickpocket,
pickpocket. Sure.
Yeah.
She had an encounter with Loser character earlier. You find out she's a North Korean defector. Her brother is in an orphanage right now because when she was crossing the border from North Korea to South Korea, her mom got caught and got sent back to the North. And so she's trying to get enough money to get a house, get her mom back. And so her and her brother and her mom can, live together and be a family again. Her brother thinks that she's, abandoned him. And so she's dealing with all that shit. So she's like this really hard case and she's like just trying to survive on her own too. And, you've got all these backstories. And so a lot of people have these really harsh lives and realities that they're dealing with. And out of the 200 some odd people that survived and the majority of them decided to leave, all but four people decided to not go back. Everybody decides to go back.
Yep.
To the Squid Game.
Yep. Another surprising.
Of the second episode.
Now, before we move further, supposedly there was a lot of controversy that came out around this show, and we were so entertained by this show, and it was so well done and well acted. I mean, come on, props to this actress. This is her first gig. She's just a model. This is her first acting role, and she did a great job. So look out, be on the lookout for her next appearance in film or TV series here. But yeah, phenomenal job from everyone. And there's a lot of, you know, memorable moments in the set design, and these are all real sets. This whole area right here is all one big huge set that they built. I mean, this took almost 10 years, the creator writing the script and pitching it and finally making it. Took almost over 10 years, you know, finally to get the green light, you know, and to make it. So we were so annoyed that there was any word of controversy that came out that we were like, you know what? We're so annoyed by that even happening that because we were entertained by the show, we really liked the show, that we didn't even bother wasting our time looking up what the controversy even is.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you this, I'm going to throw a Hail Mary at what I think the controversy is, because people were calling for this show to get banned from Netflix, and Netflix is not going to do shit. This is their number one show. They're not going to ban anything. You know, bad publicity is still good publicity, right? But here's the thing. I'm going to throw a Hail Mary here, and I'm going to just assume, I could be wrong, not going to bother looking into it, but I'm going to assume the controversy with this show is that maybe it was too violent, too brutal for audiences. I don't know. Over here in the States, I don't know. Maybe that could be it. Or people don't like reality. People don't like to see how the dark side of humanity really is. The dark side of mankind is and shown. A lot of people don't want to watch that, you know. But despite all the crazy, you know, the insane-looking sets and, you know, the large robotic doll and all this motion sensor stuff, at its core, this is kind of real. You know what I'm saying? In terms of people who are desperate, people that are down and out, will do anything for money. And this is not a new concept, like you explained. Mm. This has been around forever. Mm. And I don't know if that has something to do with it. They don't want to see how humanity really is, like the dark side of humanity really is. I don't know. What else could really be
what?
Let's ban this show. Why?
The only thing I glanced at one point was some country had problems because people were streaming the series so much that it was like jamming up the bandwidth.
Where were they streaming?
It was some country.
Oh,
I don't know if it
really?
Was some part of
okay.
of Asia.
Uh-huh.
That they were like jamming up the internet in that
okay.
particular part of the country.
Right.
But aside
oh, wow.
from that. Uh-huh. Any other controversy? I don't know. Don't really know, because this is no more violent than Walking Dead, Game of Thrones.
It's, Battle Royale?
It's no...
Everybody remember that movie?
It's really no more violent than
yeah.
any other piece of media that I've seen in the last
yeah.
10 years on regular cable television.
You know, I don't know. Maybe casuals can't take... you know, a show that's just brutal and ruthless and like, it's not a family show where you can bring Jimmy and Timmy to sit down and watch. Like, every episode is this, you know, there's death most likely, you know, and there's people betraying each other and, you know, it's just, I don't know. Well, let's move on here. But I just wanted to kind of point that out. If you guys were unaware that people were petitioning to ban this show. And it's just like, why? It doesn't make any sense. We watched it and we were like, yep, that makes sense. People will do anything for money.
Yeah.
This is not rocket science. So anyway, go ahead.
The third episode is when you start to see more of a formation of teams.
Yeah.
And teamwork. And you start to see kind of the hint of the treacherous character, the golden boy,
Judas.
You kind of start to see his kind of hints at he knows more than what he's letting on, and he's not going to say what it is because
mm-hmm.
he wants to survive.
Right.
He knows he there's a game that comes up with the honeycomb, and he kind of knew there was a possibility of he knew what was going to happen, but he didn't let the rest of the teammates, he didn't let them know what he suspected was going to happen, because he wanted to be the one to survive, and he didn't want to risk them surviving too in case it came down to just him. And of course he played innocent by the end of it all.
Oh yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And you also get the introduction to the doctor character, who is a subplot for a couple of episodes in the show, where there's this subplot in the series where him and a couple of the workers in the series are harvesting body parts, and they find this doctor and they start trading him, hints and clues for the next game for in exchange for harvesting body parts of corpses that aren't quite so mangled with bullets.
So they can make some money.
Right. And that gets the brakes put on that once the number two finds out about it, because he's like, no, that's not fair. The whole purpose of this game is so that everybody who is in here has not had a fair chance in life.
Right.
And everybody in here deserves a fair shot at this money.
Mm-hmm.
And you giving them hints is not fair. I don't care if you sell body parts. You can do whatever you want to these corpses. But you giving this guy hints is not fair. And so he shoots the worker, and then he shoots the doctor as soon as he finds out about all that after a couple of episodes. That was a thing that happened for a while. So the team aspect goes on for several episodes until basically episode 6.
Yeah, man.
Which is the one.
The team aspect came into effect again when they had like a tug of war game, which was crazy. I think my favorite was this game. This was like my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the red light, green light was fun, but this one was my favorite in terms of suspense building.
The glass bridge.
Yeah, the glass bridge was pretty crazy, man. I enjoyed that one. That was nuts. But yeah, this episode was really like, man, like, wow. I mean, you know, think of it at this point. We still really like the old man. And the show, you know, over the course of good storytelling and stuff like that, we kind of grown to like loser guy here, 456. And it comes down to the wire, you know. There was this sense of like, hey, let's work together until, you know, to survive. But at some point, eventually, it's everyone for themselves. And he actually tries to fool the old man.
Right.
You know, and I was like, this is kind of fucked up, but I understand. You're going to get shot in the head, you know what I mean? Like, I get it.
Yeah, you actually have an interesting dynamic in the marble game where everybody has to split up. And at that point, teamwork had been a good thing in the games. Teamwork had meant you survived.
Yeah.
And in this game, it was a twisteroo where you team up. So everybody's like, okay, team up with me, bestie. And in this game, whoever lost died.
Yeah.
And so you had an interesting dynamic where, but they didn't know that at first. So you had this interesting dynamic where you had two sets of people. You had the loser and the old man, and you had the Judas, and you had this other character who was from Pakistan, who had also joined the team for a while. And he was another character that had this whole fleshed out backstory, and he had been with them since the first episode also.
And I liked him.
Right.
It kind of sucked when what happened to him. Right. You know, and I was like, damn it.
And you had this interesting parallel going on where you had two sets of characters, each fooling each other in very different ways. Where you had one character fooling his partner very sympathetically, being very sad and very upset about it, and you had the other set of characters, one fooling his partner with just absolute no remorse, just absolutely just like,
yeah,
cold calculating, just like, yeah, I have to survive, I have to win this, I don't care, just like, I will fool you and That's it. Mm-hmm. It's my life. It's my life for yours. And that's it. And it was very interesting dynamic how it was shot and how it was framed.
Yeah.
You had one guy crying and just like so upset. And you had the other guy just like, nope, here you go. Here's your fake bag of rocks. You know,
yeah, that was fucked up.
And the other guy was just like, it was just so sad how the guy found out he had this sack of rocks around his neck. And it's just like,
He thought it was the marbles, but no, it was the sack of rocks.
And
Judas here on the left was pissing me off before he even betrayed the character from Pakistan, because he's all like desperate. He's all like, hey, because of my smarts, I got you this far, so now let me win. It's like, no. It's like, what kind of deal is that? Hey, I saved your life earlier, so now die for me so I can move on. It's like, I already was like done with Judas. I get it, though. You know, it's you have to have a winner. You know, I get it.
And then you had the third dynamic with the pickpocket. You had this other female character who had been introduced about an episode prior.
Yeah.
Who had been given slight backstory.
Mm-hmm.
And she had joined the group for about an episode, I guess, and pickpocket up until that point, you know, she's a street rat. She's, you know, stay away from me. She's smart. She's like, you know, I'm not mm-hmm. gonna be friends with anybody because it's just not a good idea. You know, there's no point. I'm not here to be friends. Yeah. I'm here to get the money.
Yeah.
I'm here to, you know, I'm here to get my brother back. I'm here to get my family back and blah, blah, blah. And, you know,
surprisingly, she realizes she has nothing, and she ends up, the young little girl on the left of the photo here, she ends up kind of forfeiting in a way.
Right.
And allowing Pickpocket to win.
Right.
You know, because she realized she has nothing. That's the only reason she was even in this Squid Game, or the Squid Games. She had nowhere else to go when she got out of prison for killing her father, who killed her mother. So it was just kind of, you know, interesting. She was like, well, Pickpocket's got a brother she needs to take care of. She's got a mother. So that was unexpected.
Mm-hmm.
Her kind of giving her life for her to make it.
Mm-hmm.
So now it comes down to the final three here. Judas, Loser, and Pickpocket. And, man, you know, when they gave them that steak dinner, that was a trip, man. That was a trip. They gave them a steak dinner, you know, which up to this point, their meals have kind of been crappy, you know. But steak dinner, all the trimmings, you know, once they passed, everybody, they were the only three that passed the glass bridge.
Oh, the VIPs have shown up.
Like, right.
To the actual island, by the way, at this point.
Yes, the VIPs.
And they're watching it live.
Right, right.
And after the glass bridge, which got blown to hell and exploded, Pickpocket gets, like, brutally injured. She gets this giant glass shard just lodged into her side. But she doesn't let anybody know at first.
Right, right. But that was a trip, man, where all of them are dressed up nice in suits, and they're all sitting in a nice dinner table area, and they have their steak, and they're drinking, and they're all looking at each other, you know. And Pickpocket's already, you can tell she's already kind of fading, because she's injured. And then when they're done eating, you know, the PS5 pink flamingos basically clear the table, and they only leave their dinner knives in front of them.
The steak knives
in front of them. And I was like, dude, this show is fucking brutal, man. I love it. And of course, douchebag here ends up killing Pickpocket, which really pisses off Loser here. And then we have our final finale, and then they play the Squid Game at the very end. And nice little fun, brutal fight. I'm glad the fight was kind of realistic, where it was sloppy and dirty. You know, they didn't break out in, like, martial arts fight choreography, which would have been terrible. Now, be honest.
Mm.
After he defeated Judas, right?
Mm-hmm.
He defeated Judas. Did you want him to stab Judas? I mean, he gets the money anyway. But did you want him to kill Judas, kill that motherfucker, and then take the money? Or was there a point to him?
What do you think? I thought it was fitting because he was going to stab him the night before and pickpocket stopped him.
Right.
And said, you're not that kind of man.
Right.
And it just, it made sense. And he was going to forfeit. And that's why he forfeited. He forfeited the game. He was like, I quit. I stop.
So none of them were going to get any money.
Yeah.
Until the guy stabbed himself.
Yeah.
Until Judas stabbed himself.
He stopped the game. Right. He said, if we both agree to stop, we can just go home.
Right.
And the guard was like, hey, 456 wants to stop. And before they could actually call it off, Judas stabbed himself.
Right.
And so that's how he ended up
while dying, he's like, you have all the money now. Take care of my mother, basically.
So
that's why he killed himself.
I thought it was fitting.
I thought for the storytelling aspect, I thought it was fitting as well.
I know.
But I want that motherfucker to get killed. I was like, loser, fuck this motherfucker up. Fuck him up. That's right. Yeah. I wanted him to get it. But you know, storytelling wise, I totally get it. I get it. But then later, you know.
So
I like how he didn't touch the money. A whole year goes by.
So he has this conversation with the number two, and he wants to know why. He wants to know this and that. None of his questions are answered.
Well, not the number two. The guy.
No, this is in the car. Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay.
This is in the car, directly after the games.
Okay.
And he doesn't answer his questions. He's just like, just think of this all as a dream.
Right.
And he has his mask off and everything. And he puts the mask back on. He starts to gas him up. And because he's got the blindfold on. And he falls asleep, throws him out of the vehicle. And
he's got a debit card in his mouth.
Right. He spits it out. He goes to the nearest ATM.
Yeah.
And he puts the card in and it's like, enter your PIN. And he goes 0456, which was his number. And he's got the 45.6 billion won in it. And he takes out 10,000 won, I think it is.
Right.
And that's all he ever takes out of the card. And he lives the remaining next year as just like this nobody.
Yeah.
He goes home. His mom has died.
Right.
And
he goes back to drinking again.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so a year passes and he comes across a card.
Mm-hmm.
A lady comes up to him on the beach and says, please, sir, will you buy a rose? They're going to die if I don't sell them by the end of the day.
Right.
So she gives him the card. She gives him the rose and he sees that the card attached to it. And it says, meet me at such and such place. I don't know how to pronounce it, my ganbu.
Okay.
Which means best friend.
Right.
Which is what the old man and him agreed to call each other.
Right.
That's what they called each other in the games. And he's like, what the fuck? So he goes to the place and lo and behold, there's the old man lying in bed.
One of my favorite characters in the show apparently turns out to be the ringleader.
Now, earlier in the show, we saw what appeared to be like a major VIP guy with a gold mask from behind with old man hands.
Yeah.
Take his mask off, and we never saw that character again. And we're like, oh, who's that? Okay. Never saw him again. Well, come to find out, this motherfucker who's been saying this whole time that he's had a tumor in his head and he's got, you know, memory problems and blah, blah, blah. Well, he does have a tumor in his head.
Right.
But he is, he's the ringleader of this whole situation. And he just wanted to participate in the games just once. Because when he was a child, he loved playing games and he never felt more alive than when he was playing and frolicking and doing all this, all this stuff.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
But it's like, you know, he kind of made a little side bet with him. You know, there was a homeless guy on the street who was cold and kind of dying and people were just walking by and nobody was helping the homeless man. And he was just like, you know, let's play a bet. Let's see if someone actually shows up to help him. You know, he's like,
before midnight.
Yeah, yeah. Before midnight. He's like, do you still believe in humanity after all that you've been through? You know, and he kind of And then Loser was kind of like, why'd you do this? And he was like, well, although, you know, go back to your gambling with your gambling in the horse races. You guys were the horses, you know, you guys are cattle. That's how I look at it. So that, you know, that kind of pissed him off. But somebody did eventually come by and help out the homeless guy.
Like one minute to midnight.
Yeah, 1 minute to midnight. And then he passes, he dies.
Yeah, right? like right at midnight, and he turns around and he's right. Like, you saw it, didn't you? You saw it, didn't you? But, right. You know.
And then that kind of motivates our guy to, you know what, let me stop wasting around here. He cleans himself up, you know. He gets himself the good old-fashioned midlife crisis hairdo here. And I like this scene. You want to talk about this scene?
As you do. As you do.
And then he actually helps Pickpocket's brother.
Right.
He helps Judas's mother. He does keep his promises. And then...
yeah, he gives her a bunch of money with the kid.
Right, right.
He says, this is the money that I owed Judas.
And he's going to... do we know where he was traveling to?
It kind of seems like he was going to go see the daughter. His daughter. Because the daughter was going to America
right,
with her mom and
right.
the family.
That's
the
right.
new family.
Right. So let's go ahead and talk about this scene.
But so... He's on the train. Now, originally, he found the first guy. The first time he ever comes across the card is when he's on the train station. He's in the subway. And he meets this guy, and the guy has a card. And he plays this game where you place a bet. And if you win, you get a whole bunch of money. If you lose, you have to keep taking these hard slaps.
Right.
And the only way to get your money back is if you win. And just to show how bad of a gambler you are, how bad of an addiction you have, you just keep losing and keep losing. If you win once, you know, blah, blah, blah. But that's how you get the card initially.
Yeah.
And he's across the aisle to where you can't get to the guy immediately. You have to cross the bridge to get to the guy. He sees
right.
this guy getting the shit slapped out of him. It's the guy from Train to Busan.
The dad from Train to Busan, yeah.
He sees the guy slapping the shit out of this other guy, and he freaks out. And he's like, oh, shit. He drops his luggage, and he runs across the bridge to get to the guy. And by the time he gets there, it's just the guy that was getting slapped, and he looks inside the train, and the guy is in the train. Train to Busan dad is yeah. in the train.
The recruiter.
Waving to
him. He recruits people for the Squid Game.
And then the yeah. train goes off.
And he kind of waves to him.
He turns around yeah. to the guy who's getting slapped, and he shoves him up against the wall, and he's like, never, never, ever, ever, pretty much. And he takes the card from him.
Yeah, yeah.
So
he's like, what are you doing? I mean, the guy doesn't know.
Yeah.
The guy doesn't know, but he's just like paranoid. He's like, you don't want to go through what I went through.
Yeah.
And here's where it gets interesting. Go ahead.
So he takes the card from the guy and he goes to the airport and he's on the phone with them. He's on the phone with his daughter, I'm assuming. And he gets off the phone and he looks at the card and he... And I'm like, what are you doing?
I know.
You were out. You already
I know, right?
So he calls the number. And it's like, do you wish to play the game? And he is like, if you wish to play the game.
And he says, I have a certain set of skills. I will find you. No, he doesn't say it.
It says, if you wish to play the game, leave your name and state your name and your birthday. And so he does. And I'm like, oh, what are you doing? What are you doing? And he says, this is my name. This is my birthday. We are not horses. And
we are not cattle.
Right.
I am not cattle.
Yeah. Right.
And what's interesting is they tell him over the phone, you need to, whatever cockamamie ideas you're having right now about coming to find us or whatever the fuck, get rid of that shit and get your ass on that plane. Which shows right there, they're watching him. They're watching him. Even though he's out, they're watching him. And I was like, oh shit. Mm-hmm. And he turns around like a fucking G with his midlife crisis hair color do. And just walks back, you know, determined. And, you know, that's how it ends. And it was very well made, well acted. I mean, it was just first class all around. So we went over spoilers already. But those of you who have just arrived right now that are watching, we highly recommend you guys definitely check out Squid Game. You're going to end up binging it just like we did. It's very well done. Very well done. Anything else about, oh, here we go. Eric, what's going on? Eric's in the house. He likes the cameos on there. Oh, what was interesting is we came across a video that was talking about secrets and Easter eggs. Totally went over my head. Is that when they play the first, the real name of this character is it?
Oh, I don't have it up.
Ilnam? What's it? It's, here it is. I got it right here. Hold on. This is where I need Eric. There he is. Olinam. Or Ilnam. I think I'm saying it wrong. I apologize. But that actually translates for one. Right?
One man.
One, what is it?
One man.
One man or something like that. What's interesting is, with the secrets and Easter eggs, is during this game right here, the red light, green light, if you notice when the robot is scanning people that are moving, it doesn't scan him. And that blew my mind. It does not scan the old man. And I was like, holy shit. It just goes around him and scans everybody else to see who's moving so it, you know, that person could get shot. I didn't know there was clues. There's actually clues. The area where they were all staying in right here, on the walls, you could see clues to what each game is going to be. That blew my mind as well. So there's just all kinds of little Easter eggs and things and secrets. If you look for them, you might be able to figure stuff out. Were there any others? Easter egg secrets?
Some of the deaths were foreshadowed.
Yes, some of the deaths were foreshadowed. That's right, yeah. Let's see here. That was it, though, right? In terms of that stood out in terms of secrets and Easter eggs. I'm sure you guys will probably find more if you look for them. But yeah, there was definitely some cool Easter egg shit you guys can discover and secrets that I totally went over my head. But now, let's get to the real reason I'm sure everybody's here. Now, it's in the title. It's in the description. It's right here. Spoiler talk for Venom 2. If you don't want to hear spoilers, go watch the movie and come back later, okay? Because I see people showing up in chat right now and they're saying, I haven't seen Venom 2 yet. It's in the title. Spoilers, okay? It's in the title. It's in the description. It's right here. So if you guys don't want to hear Venom 2 spoilers, you know, if you don't want to hear them, you know, enjoy the movie or go watch the movie and then come back. All right. But we're going to get into it. We wanted to get into it on our review, but we didn't have time to because we ran out of time. All right. Venom 2 Electric Boogaloo. All right. Entertainingly bad?
I guess.
Like we said, comedy of the year. You know, like we said in our review, you have to approach this movie as a comedy. If you're looking for a serious, dark, violent, gritty Venom movie with carnage in it, you're not going to get it. That doesn't mean it's not entertaining enough. Like, you won't find some entertainment, but if that's what you're looking for, you're probably going to be pissed off. Okay, I'm just going to let you guys know. We actually gave it an average rating. You gave it an average rating.
Uh-huh.
You found it to be entertaining, but dumb.
It was
at the same time.
Listen.
I gave it a 3.3, I think, out of 5. I said it was a little bit above average in terms of just blind entertainment. You get some goofy moments. You get some over the top moments. But in terms of what people really wanted to see, I think a lot of fans, like I said, there's people that enjoy this movie and think it's great. I think that's great. Mm. But there's a lot of fans pissed. There's a lot of fans pissed because they're calling this movie now Venom, Let There Be Minimum Carnage. There's not maximum carnage. There's not a lot of carnage. There's a little bit a carnage here. So we just want to warn you, like, if you're going in expecting carnage, to have a decapitated head holding it up and throwing it at the cops laughing, if that's what you want to see, you're not going to get this. This is a PG-13 movie, okay? Here we go. Brolacon. SNES's Maximum Carnage had more violence. And we mentioned that in our review, that we found this movie at best to be big, dumb fun. And that's us being generous. But we didn't hate it. But a lot of people hate this movie, okay? They hate it. It's making a lot of money, which is cool for the filmmakers. And, you know, we like Andy Serkis. But, you know, the big over-the-top acting from Woody Harrelson and the character Francis, this kind of, you know, I felt, you know what this movie feels like to me? This feels like a late 90s, early 2000s comic book movie. That's what this feels like. I was getting Batman Forever vibes. You know, I was that's what this felt like to me. Okay. Did you feel, I mean, we were glad that the movie was short and sweet and to the point. Like, we were happy the movie was 90 minutes because we're tired of every single movie that comes out has to be over 2 hours. Mm. Like, not every single movie has to be over 2 hours. But did you feel watching this that things were cut to make it a shorter running time? Did you feel like there was actually more, but the potential of more character development?
Well, like I said, I didn't like the first movie. I felt like a shit ton was cut.
Okay.
Like,
okay.
I felt like that was just like, what the fuck? I thought maybe in the third act, something felt like it was missing.
Okay.
But aside from that, not really.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I can't put my finger on it, what it was in the third act.
It did feel like there was some fast editing in terms of like, oh, we're here now, but nothing that annoyed us. You know what I mean? Nothing that we were like confused.
Yeah.
We still could tell what's happening in the story.
Like I felt like I said this in the review for the first, like in our spoiler free review.
Yeah.
The first movie, I felt like it needed a total reworking. I felt like, I hated the first movie. I didn't hide my feelings for the first movie.
I did
like,
too. I had issues with
like,
it.
Like I can't stand the first movie. I didn't find it funny. I felt like the movie just didn't work. It was too flawed to be like a coherent film. I didn't find it amusing. I didn't find it funny. I felt like it was missing too much to be coherent at all.
Yeah.
And like it failed as a buddy film. It failed as an action movie. It failed as, you know, I just didn't think it worked. I felt like it needed to be rewritten.
Parts of it was entertaining, but overall it was disappointing. But what's funny is how some people, not everyone, feel about this movie and they're really pissed off. It's kind of how we felt about the first movie. But like I mentioned in our review is, now that we're introduced to the odd couple world of Venom with shenanigans, seeing it in this movie, it didn't really bother me as much. And we've seen this world, this is the world they're going with, so let's see what happens. So that's why we probably don't hate this movie as much as other people do. But it's by no means, this is a movie that's great or worth defending. But we're here to talk spoilers. All right, so let's get into it here. So Venom, Let There Be Carnage. Eddie Brock attempts to reignite his career by interviewing serial killer Cletus Kasady, who becomes the host of the symbiote Carnage and escapes prison after a failed execution. Directed by Andy Serkis, starring Michelle Williams, Woody Harrelson, excuse me, Naomi Harris, Tom Hardy, and the rest. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. All right. So, again, the big overacting, which a lot of from the villains, a lot of people could kind of look at that as cringeworthy. I think that's what Andy Serkis was going for, clearly. I think that's what he was trying to do.
Yeah.
I don't think this was a phoned-in performance. I know a lot of people said they were disappointed with Woody's performance. I don't think Woody performed bad. I think Woody performed good. I just think they didn't give him a lot to do. You know, they didn't give him a lot to work with. The most sinister thing, in my opinion, that he did was stomp a mud hole in some guy's head after robbing him at a gas station. That's about it. But this movie feels like, oh, this really needed to be rated R, man.
You know,
it feels neutered. You know what this movie feels like? This feels like you watched the TV edit.
It really did.
That's what this feels like.
And, you know, for it being a bunch of symbiotes, for being two, well, one and a half symbiotes, because Carnage is barely a symbiote in this film.
Yeah.
He's a half a symbiote. Like, he's... I still don't understand how this works. Like, listening to his original backstory, he's supposed to be an offspring of Venom. And in this film, he's literally a drop of Venom's blood.
Right.
Which is basically just, he's
mixed in.
He's a drop of Eddie Brock's blood with Venom mixed in.
Right, right.
Which somehow becomes Carnage after it mixes in, after Cassidy swallows it and then gets mixed with.
Yes.
With death juice.
Yes. Science.
That's how happens. He becomes Carnage, which I still don't fucking understand it. Anyway. So he's barely Carnage as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
So for them being two symbiotes.
Right.
They barely touch each other. And it's like, but they're aliens.
Right.
Why aren't they allowed to go at it? I don't understand. How come they're not allowed to, like, hurt each other? They feel so neutered.
Yeah.
It's so absurd why they can't just, like, you know?
Yeah.
It's so dumb. It's so irritating. It's so, like, I know I'm spoiled by the Suicide Squad. I get it. I am thoroughly ruined by that film and how brutally violent it was. But this movie felt like a Disney Plus chant, like a Disney Plus.
It felt like a TV edit.
It was just,
especially with the prison break. There's moments there's edits during the prison break where you're gonna be like, wait, did that person just die? Like, what happened?
Yeah.
And you know, but here's the thing. So the end of the first movie, remember, they make a deal, right? He becomes the lethal protector, right? At the very end, we are Venom, and he bites the motherfucker's, the criminal's brain. Who was robbing the lady's shop, right? So some of you might be pissed off because that's how the last movie ended. So this movie, he's not the lethal protector. He calls himself the lethal protector. But Eddie basically is like, no. You don't eat anybody's brains. I've changed my mind. You don't even eat villains' brains. You can have some chicken brains. You can have some chickens. But you can't eat anybody's brains. So that might be disappointing for some people because majority of the first movie is the odd couple syndrome, right? You know, them arguing constantly back and forth. Now, keep in mind, the positives of this is Tom Hardy's performance is great. Tom Hardy is very, very good in this. He's very good in this movie. But if you're expecting vigilante lethal protector Venom going after bad guys and eating their brains, you're not going to get that in this movie until the very end of the movie, which we're going to get to. So again, the odd couple shenanigans, some of it's funny, some of it's cringe, some of it's not so funny, but there are funny moments. And it comes down to, you know, Tom Hardy's performance. He's kind of the glue. I think if you get a generic actor who really couldn't pull this off, this movie would be even worse, I think. But Tom Hardy does the best that he can. He commits to the character and does the best that he can to make it work. But they have a falling out. they have an argument. You're nothing without me, Eddie. And, hey, you know, I'm Eddie Brock. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you're making me breakfast around there. Eddie Brock. You know what I'm saying? And then, so they have the authentic Tom Hardy impression right there, right? So they have a falling out. You know, fuck Eddie Brock. Fuck this guy, man. He's nothing without me. He's just a loser. Blah, 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 blah. So they have a falling out. So Venom leaves Eddie after they have kind of a hilarious fight in the apartment complex, and he leaves. He ends up fucking up his bike and all that stuff. But again, just not to skip over too much. Earlier we had, you know, our boy Cletus Cassidy here, played by Woody. And go ahead and, you know, talk about that. The that whole plot synopsis there.
Which part, from the beginning or?
Okay. So basically, he calls on, just like the end of the first movie, the end credits scene, right? Where Brock shows in. Brock comes in to visit Cletus. Cletus requests him to do an interview, right? So he basically says, I want you to print this in the newspaper, and if you do this for me, then I will give you my secrets of my life and why I'm crazy and all that stuff. So he prints a message in the newspaper, and the message is for the love of his life, Francis Shriek here. Basically kind of giving her the heads up that he's going to break out and he's going to break her out, basically. In the cell, Cletus' cell, Venom notices, starts picking up clues here. And Venom kind of helps Eddie Brock. This is way before the fallout, and try to figure out, you know, clues and try to figure out what is Cletus really up to here. And I was actually happy later in the movie when when Venom does leave Eddie Brock. Eddie Brock's a journalist, so I was actually kind of happy that you do get a moment where Eddie Brock actually starts figuring some shit out on his own. Mm-hmm. Because the way the movie was coming out, it was just like he was like a literally nothing. like Venom was doing everything. So it was kind of nice to see Eddie do his, you know, what he's known for and figure out some clues as well. We do not get a lot of backstory on Cletus. It's kind of shown quickly in an animated presentation. When Cletus sends him this card here.
You get a little backstory at the very beginning when they're younger.
Right.
And then you get the animated.
Right.
And you get the little animation. And then that's about it.
Yeah.
And then you get a little exposition at the very end when he's talking about his grandmother and his mother that all abused him. And then that's it.
So this is another thing that some fans are pissed off about. Cletus Cassidy is Carnage. Carnage. And to steal lines from Terminator, you can't reason with it. What is it? What is this?
You can't bargain with it.
You can't bargain with it. Sorry. You can't reason with it. And it will not stop until you are dead. That's what fans have said Carnage is supposed to be. They tried to give you the sympathetic angle. Like, oh, he's abused. Mm. And he just wants a friend. So are you supposed to feel sorry for the mass murderer?
That came out of nowhere.
And that came out of nowhere. And I think I think fans are probably like, no. Carnage is Carnage. He will cut off a guy's head, hold it up to the cops, and go bowling with the head.
Well,
and laugh about it.
And in this version also,
for some reason in this version, they try to give you some kind of sympathetic angle.
Well, and also in this version, his motivation is his girlfriend / wife Shriek. And they also go so far as to not even have him bond with Carnage. They're not fully bonded. Like, Eddie and Venom are bonded.
And they say we. When they talk, they say we.
Right.
You notice Carnage in the movie says I.
Right. They are not fully bonded.
Yeah.
So at any given time, Carnage will just take over and just do his own thing. And Shriek, as you know, shrieks. She apparently is a mutant. And she has a very large, like a very loud projectile voice. And when she shrieks, she fucks up Carnage. And he says at one point, if she does that again, I'm going to rip her face off.
Now imagine if it was rated R, how much entertaining that would be, you know?
Right.
Better shut that fucking bitch up.
Right. And
that'd been great.
At one point, she does it again, and he takes over and he attacks her.
Right.
And Cassidy's like, dude, what are you doing? Stop it. That's my wife. Cut it out.
Yeah.
And so that's the angle that they're going for in the third act. And this is where the third act really, I guess that's where I thought that the movie falls apart. And that's where the third act is good and terrible at the same time.
Yeah.
The third act, you have this really great fight between Venom and Carnage, yeah, where the special effects are beautiful.
You get a showdown.
You get this really interesting fight where this bell, this church bell, is going off. It goes, it's going ding, ding, back and forth, and it's taking a long time for it to go back and forth.
And it's fucking both of them up.
So you get this, these moments where the bell is going ding, and the symbiotes retreat back into their hosts.
Right.
And so it literally goes from the symbiotes being actual symbiotes and them fighting as the symbiotes. And as soon as the bell tolls, they retreat into the human bodies. And so it then becomes Tom Hardy and Woody Harrelson. And then they start fighting each other.
Yeah.
And as soon as the reverberations and the sound stops, the symbiotes come back out and then they start fighting as the symbiotes.
Yeah.
It's a great visual. Yeah. And again, the special effects look fantastic on the screen. And so this fight is going on. And unfortunately, somewhere in between this fight, Michelle Williams has been kidnapped because Carnage and Cassidy have decided to have this plot where Cassidy wants to hurt
Brock.
And
Shriek wants revenge on the cop.
Yeah, because the cop is who shot her when she was young, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
And nice shot there.
Yeah.
And so they're all tied.
And they want to get married.
They're getting married during all this.
The red wedding.
Yes, it's very convoluted. Again, it's that shit stupidity at its finest.
Who said romance is dead? Yeah. That is the acting in this. I'm not over exaggerating.
Right. So all of this.
So
is
if you're okay with that, you might find entertainment.
All of this is going on, and this really nice visual fight is going on. And again, this is where it all just goes to hell in a handbasket.
Yeah.
And this is where I was like, oh, what are we doing? Shriek ends up outside of the church.
She's trying to kill the cop.
Yeah. Right. And Brock, Venom and Carnage are fighting.
Yeah.
While they're turning in and out of Venom and Carnage and blah, blah, blah. And at one point, Carnage grabs Anne.
Yeah.
And
this was so bad.
Grabs her, pulls her out of the church in front of Shriek.
Yeah.
Shriek looks up. Now, Shriek, keep in mind, is the one who kidnapped Anne in the first place.
Yeah.
As bait.
Yes.
Now, Shriek was like, oh, it'd be a shame to hurt you, love. Okay. But still, she's crazy.
She's fucking psycho.
Okay? Shriek looks up at Anne, who's all tentacle hentai'd out, right? And she goes, this is going too far, my love.
Really? I was in the theater like, this is so fucking dumb, man.
What character?
She should be yelling, finish her off.
Character 180 much?
That was bad. There's no defending that. That was fucking horrible. We're going too far. 3 minutes earlier, I'm going to kill the fucking cop. Die.
It was awful.
3 minutes later.
It was like the writing.
What are you doing?
The writing. Now,
Jesus
granted,
Christ.
The writing has been just like borderline trash. Okay. But this was just like, okay. I have suffered a lot through this film. For the benefit of, okay.
And entertained as well. But yeah,
it's right. Like, okay, I will go with it because I appreciate that this is dumb. But damn, that was just the absolute worst. Okay.
That was really bad. That almost ruined the end finale. That almost ruined it. I'm like, really? What is happening? You know?
And so I think she shrieks again or I don't remember she shrieked again and that fucked with him or whatever happened.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Obviously Anne survived and everybody, you know, she...
The bell fell on her.
Right,
and she died.
Poetic justice.
But we're missing a lot of stuff. I was trying to lead up to the finale here. We'll get back to the finale in a second. Let's rewind a little bit here, okay? So I know during my review, some of you were asking, man, I wonder what really made him laugh and convulse and looked like he was having a stroke in the theater and Lady Fatblood was checking on him. It was because the acting was so over the top. So you have Venom here breaking out of prison, right? So he turns into Tasmanian Devil. Okay. Well, before that, he kind of fucks up guards, but it was hard to tell how he was fucking them up. Again, we're watching the PG TV edit version. And this is another good reason of... Here's another good example of why this needed to be R. You have this sequence right here where he picks up the guard. He places him. He shoves him against the wall, right? And they're looking at him. He's mugging him, right? And the guy goes, "Please don't. I have a family," right? And then what do you expect to happen out of that, right? Whoosh, disemboweled, drawn and quartered, right?
Take the head off.
Something, right? Eat some motherfucking brains, right? No, he just sticks his tongue in his mouth and takes the tongue back out. That's it. And just drops him. And you feel like, were there supposed to be sound effects there that he's eating his insides? Like, it was just like, there you go. Nice little French kiss. And you're done. And then he moved, and it's just like this. Come on, man. Come on. This was my issue with the movie. Despite being entertained, believe it or not, in a bad movie way, I was entertained, believe it or not, by the movie. But yeah, it was just like, you know, I have a family, don't. Give me that tongue, baby. Right?
Oh, no.
But this is what made me die laughing hysterically. So he does a Tasmanian devil. We have a carnage tornado, which kind of fucks up the whole prison. During this huge CGI set piece, Carnage turns into a fucking tornado, right? It's like huge, big deal, right? Inside the tornado, he has the warden. And it's so ridiculously looking. It looks so ridiculous in Woody's overacting. And what he says here, I was losing it. So huge set piece, tornado, twister, right? And all of a sudden he goes, "You got any last words, warden?" And that's exactly how he said it. I was in the theater like this. I was watching. And he says that line. And I go... She was like, "Are you okay?" Like, I lost it. I completely lost it. "You got any last words, warden?" Oh, my God. You think I'm overacting? No, that is exactly how he says it in the movie. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. So, again, blue balls. We're getting blue balls here. And then we're getting hilariosity moments here. Right? And, oh, don't think we're skipping on this scene. So, when it gets, just to show how just bonkers this movie is, for better or for worse. Did you know Venom goes to a rave? Oh my God. Oh my God. If you're not laughing right now, what's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? Okay. Venom, when he has his falling out with Eddie Brock, he goes to a rave. And I was so fucking scared that Venom was going to break out in a rap. If Venom started rapping, I would have given this movie 0 stars.
Or 5.
Or 5. I don't know. It's one of those movies, man. Right? So, yeah, he goes up there and just kind of rants about Eddie, and the crowd takes it as inspirational speech. And Venom does a mic drop, you guys. Venom does mic drop. And he says, "Lethal Protector out." Lethal Protector out, and then he drops the mic. What, son? What y'all know about Venom? Huh? Right? Because in a Carnage movie, Carnage in it, right? I know what y'all really wanted. Y'all wanted Venom, Lethal Protector out, mic drop. Woo! Oh, my God. Woo! Oh, shit. So anyway, I wanted to make sure we did not skip all of that. But again, you know, them trying to give him a sympathetic angle, I think, was a mistake. He should have been mass murdering, like, tons of people. And even though he had Venom, kind of really, I mean, Carnage really only really had three big set pieces. He breaks out of the prison, do some French kissing, and then he kind of destroys some police vehicles and stuff like that. I actually did like Carnage's roar. I liked his roar. That was kind of fun. But yeah, I just want to make sure we didn't skip the any last questions, Warden, or any last words, Warden. I want to make sure you didn't miss that. But now, again, like you were saying, Lady Fatblood was saying, the showdown was entertaining. It was definitely, in my opinion, more satisfying than the showdown in the first movie, which I was just extremely bored with the showdown in the first film. This was a lot more satisfying. I did enjoy when, before he goes and fights Carnage, what did he say? He says something about, "Time to die!"
Oh, yeah.
Right? And then
he's like, that's the spirit. He's like, I was talking about us.
Yeah, he's like, I was talking about us. That was hilarious. That was hilarious because he was like, fuck this. It was a red one. We don't want to mess with that. So, you know, with every PG-13 movie, you're allowed one decapitation and one fuck. So they saved that fuck for the very end, and I enjoyed it. You know, he's like, fuck this guy. You know, bites and eats Cletus's brains, and then sucks in the rest of the red symbiote. I don't know what happens after that in terms of the comic lore, but yeah, that was kind of fun. But let's get to the big scene here. Let's see here. So Eddie and Venom are out. They have a moment on the beach, and Venom expresses his love for Eddie, which was kind of funny. Eddie's reaction was kind of funny. He kind of laughed at that. He's like, "I know. Did you just say you just love me?" You know, it was kind of funny. But they're in this hotel room, and I'll let you explain. Go ahead. What happens next?
Oh, well, Venom was pretty much explaining that they have a collective intelligence, the symbiotes do, and Eddie could not... He could not understand. He would not be able to. His pea brain would not be able to understand. Right. It would blow his tiny little mind, like right. A fraction of it. And Eddie's like, "Well, try me." And he's like, "Okay, I will give you a taste." And so he goes to show him, and all of a sudden the room starts to shake, and it kind of like twitches a little bit. Yeah. And Eddie and Venom are kind of like, "Whoa, what the hell was that?" And Venom's like, They're both kind of like, "Whoa, I don't know." And the TV flashes. They look at the TV, and you hear J. Jonah Jameson
right.
talking about the Spider Menace.
Right.
And ta-da.
Yeah. And then Venom goes up there, and he goes, "This guy." And he licks the screen, which is definitely a cool Venom thing to do. And finally... it's been talk for 5 billion years, and it looks like it was never going to happen. But the fact that they even had this scene here is the reason why fans are calling that this scene is the best part of the movie, even though it's in the credits. Because finally, we get at least a confirmation that Venom will meet up with Spidey in the future. Now, remember, he's Lethal Protector. So Spider-Man basically is being shown here on the news as a menace, as a villain. So he's going to do his Lethal Protector thing and go after Spider-Man. Now, will Venom make an appearance in the next Spider-Man movie? Is that too many villains in that movie? I hope he doesn't just show up in that movie and kind of be wasted. Maybe they should build to their confrontation. But a lot of fans are excited for the possibilities of Venom finally throwing down with Spider-Man. But the problem is now, because of this movie, there's not going to be the Venom and Spider-Man team up against Carnage, because Carnage is dead. Well, at least Cletus is dead. So it's kind of like, maybe they shouldn't have killed Cletus and he just got arrested. And then you can do whatever you want with the character later, but he's dead. So I don't know if that's even going to happen now. But they alluded to this character. This is the cop his eyes started to glow. A lot of fans are saying that he will become Toxin, which is another symbiote. There's a lot of fan theories going around in this. So let me know in the comments below what you guys think this character is going to be. The problem is I don't think people care. That's the problem. Shriek just kind of felt like a throwaway villain to me. Carnage, even though Woody did the best with what he was given to do. He did the best with what he had to work with. And you do get some great visuals of Carnage, and you get some fun Carnage moments. But Carnage is neutered. He's kind of neutered in this. And another good example, what I wanted to show was, at the end, he's throwing like these darts at Venom. Venom's getting kind of stabbed. Later, Venom's walking on his, you know, he's kind of crawling. And Carnage is stabbing through his hands. I think he kind of stabs through his chest a little bit. And then you get this weird, odd moment. And this is what I mentioned in the review, but I couldn't really go into detail. He picks up Venom, throws him against the wall, right? Makes he can form blades and knives and stuff, right? He basically goes to shank and stab Venom up against the wall, and they cut away. And I'm like, why? Why? It's an alien stabbing another fucking alien. That shouldn't be violent. It's an alien symbiote stabbing another alien symbiote. Why would you cut away from that? It's so annoying. So you have that bullshit, but then at the same time you have Time to Die, which was hilarious. Mm. So that's why this movie for us, everyone's different. There's people that love this movie, people hate this movie. That's why for us, this is in the middle. Mm. Because you do get entertaining moments, but then you do get cringe and just odd, like, why moments. And, you know, like I said, I gave it like a 3.3, I think. And it's a little bit above average in terms of entertainment. But, you know, it's such a interesting experiment. But here's the thing. A lot of people, yes. AVP is better.
Stabbing each other.
Yeah, at least they stabbed each other. So there were some alien decapitations at least. But the thing is, you know, everyone's has their fingers crossed, as well as we do. We would love to see Spider-Man versus Venom done right, because in our opinion, it wasn't done right in Spider-Man 3, even though Spider-Man 3 has its fans. Even though you can like Spider-Man 3, that's fine, to each his own. But come on now. They didn't do Venom right in that movie either. Okay? And Eddie Brock, I hated that fucking character played by, was it Topher Grace? Mm. Fucking hated him. Eddie Brock, Daily Bugle. I mean, it's fucking horrible. When him coming out of the Venom, symbiote and going, I'm so disappointed in you, Parker. I mean, just fuck off. Seriously, fuck off. Spider-Man 3 Venom. Seriously. Mm. So we don't get that in here. We get kind of a odd couple buddy cop Venom, which is not for everyone's taste. So we do have our fingers crossed for the future. Hopefully it's fucking dope, man. I want to be there. I want to pay my ticket and be there and see them on the screen and see them fight and maybe team up in the future. Fingers crossed. I hope it turns out well. I really do. Despite this movie, I hope it comes out well. But I don't know. should we? Is it okay to hope, but not be too excited?
I wouldn't be.
Right.
I wouldn't be at this rate. It's Sony.
Yeah.
It is Sony.
I'm just gonna show this one more time.
Like I said, this movie was so fucking dumb. this like I give Aquaman grief for being one of the dumbest movies I've ever seen, but it was still entertaining.
Yeah, yeah.
And it at least, yeah. You know.
It's got to be entertaining. If it's dumb, it still has to be entertaining for us to give it a pass.
Yeah.
It's when it's not entertaining is when we get pissed off.
This movie at least, this movie was so bad that at least, it was so bad it's good in a lot of ways, but like I said, I didn't find myself laughing at a lot of the jokes, which is odd because usually bad comedies irritate the shit out of me.
Right, right.
But for some reason, the tone, the bizarrety of it all, it was almost like a Gods of Egypt, except Gods of Egypt was so far up its own ass.
Yeah, Gods of Egypt thought it was going to be great.
Right.
Yeah, it's different. It's because of Tom.
Yeah.
It's because of Tom's performance.
Yeah.
He goes all in. He's like, this is the goofy shtick I'm a part of. Fuck it. Let me do the best that I can to give a great performance and have fun.
Right.
Playing both characters. He's arguing with himself. You know, and you can get some entertainment out of that. But do these characters deserve better? Of course they do. I would love to see Carnage hold up a decapitated head and throw it like a grenade at police and laugh. I mean, I think that would be the only reason why I'm mentioning that is that happened.
Yeah.
In the comic.
Like I think this would have done better as a dark comedy with violence.
Yeah, yeah.
Like
yeah.
If you had thrown an R rating on this and again had this been more brutal and
yeah. Yeah.
You know, but
and in actually, you know, Iron Wolf has a good point here. If in comparison, as of right now, Morbius does look like a more of a serious movie than this one. But hopefully Morbius is good. Hopefully Morbius doesn't feel like this movie where it feels like a TV edit because they can't, even though it's a fucking vampire, gotta be PG-13. You know what I mean? I would love Morbius to be R-rated, but here's the thing. Suicide Squad, as much as we were entertained by it, did not do well in theaters. Most likely, I don't know if DC is going to take risks now with R-rated comic book properties. You know what I mean? They may not do that now. And the thing is this movie made a lot of money. So why would they make Morbius R-rated?
That was There's still...
No, why would they make Blade R-rated?
Well, and that's the thing. That's right? The other thing to consider.
Even though it needs to be R-rated.
That's the other thing to consider. The Suicide Squad, that was Warner Brothers and DC's fault for putting that to HBO and simultaneously releasing it to the theater.
Right, right.
And Sony is still in partial conjunction with Marvel DC right now. So they can't do a rated R film.
Right.
They can't have anything R-rated right now.
Right.
That's why Blade isn't going to be R-rated. They can't do it. So it's almost like we're in a catch-22. So the Suicide Squad would have done better if they hadn't done the HBO deal. So that was their fucking fault, which...
Right.
Stupid. Stupid!
Yeah.
You know? No shit! No shit it didn't make money. Yeah. You know? It's like, obviously.
Yeah.
And... Unfortunately, as long as you're selling your soul to Satan Disney, you're never going to get an R-rated film. Unfortunately, that's just how it is.
Yeah. 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 But I think we've ranted enough about Venom 2 Electric Boogaloo.
Yes.
A lot of people hate it. A lot of people love it. And there's probably some rare few that are like us. We're in the middle on it.
Profoundly stupid. Absolutely.
But let us know in the comments below what you guys thought of Squid Game and Venom. Let there be minimum carnage. And let us know. Give us your honest thoughts. Did you love it? Did you hate it? Do you think it was overrated or underrated? Let us know. I'd like to thank all our badass channel members for supporting us and our Patreon members. Thank you so much for supporting the channel. You guys fucking rock as usual. Don't forget tonight, join us again, 6 p.m. Pacific time. We're going to talk about Halloween H2O 20 years later. We're going to discuss that film because 'tis the motherfucking season, son. That's right. And we may review some old school horror films tomorrow. Maybe. We might. Maybe. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Depends on my schedule tomorrow.
Yeah, it depends on her schedule. We might do it. We watched some old school fun movies recently that it would be fun to talk about with you guys tomorrow. Get some more horror-related content on the channel. And don't forget, Versus this week is coming as well. Thursday, and we will have another special guest will show up, unless he's extremely busy and he pulls out. But yeah, you guys are awesome. Thanks again for hanging out with us and watching us rant. That's right. And don't forget to subscribe and like the video and hit the notification bell. Ring-a-ding-ding. The Red Wedding. Who said romance is dead?
Okay.
Take care, guys.
Okay.